lot of people are afraid of me. Not that I will hit them. No, they're afraid because my knowledge. I was there from the first day. I know who is who and what they did. They're all dead now. Bos, Bugel, Krebas, Meijer. These are my medals. My first platoon on board the ship to Korea. Snoeys is still alive and he is still alive. The rest is all dead. Well, Giesink in those days, of course, was the famous champion. He came to Japan in February 1961. He was fighting that side, I was fighting here. And he was beautiful. Wow, it was unbelievable. But he saw me fighting, and Draker told me, he walked away and shook his head. Phew. He said, you were so good. So then he said in an interview, when Blooming comes back to Holland, he will be a very good member of the judo team. Because he is really good. Then they sent me a clipping from the newspaper that Giesink said Blooming was just a big mouth and he was nothing at all and fuck Blooming. I was astonished because I just became fourth dan in Korea. I threw the Korean champion, Kim. So I knew I couldn't trust him. And when I came back in the end of 1961, I wanted to participate in the World Championships in Paris. And I couldn't. Giesink said, no, 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 no. And the union said, no, 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 no. So that was it. I couldn't participate. So I was very, very mad. And so I challenged him six times. He never came. He never came. Now he says, yeah, it's because of the union. They set us up against each other. Okay. Well, of course, until a certain height. But it was him personally. Now we meet each other. Hey, Tontje, how are you? It's water under the bridge. But it hurt me very much. I am from Kodokan, fourth dan. In, I think, summer 1960, after I demolished Kaminaka. But it's very funny. And that's one of the ways I think that Kodokan lost out in the all-over world judo politics. Because I was the one who was the Dai Shi Han for Risei Kano on European affairs. So I told him what was going on, what is going to happen. I told him in 1960, there will be a world union. One country, one vote. And then the Japanese are finished because you only have one vote. He said, oh, no, no, no. We made judo. We will tell them what to do. I said, oh, no, no, no. And I said, and then there are going to be championships. Light heavy. Light middle, light heavy, heavy. All categories, six titles. No. Judo is for everybody. Small man can beat big man. I said, no, never happened. Never happened. How come they didn't beat me here? And I'm not even Japanese. So in 66, when I came back to Japan, he called me in and he said, Blooming Sensei, I have to apologize to you. Because you were right all the way. I said, of course, they tell me. And I told you. He said, yes, I'm sorry, but it is a sad day for judo. Well, in a way it is, because what they do now is judo. This is not judo anymore. This looks like Godo. It's not the movement anymore. It's the strength. If you see the, oh, and then the boom, boom, boom. Well, we started. I remember that I looked at his hand and he said, oh, you can have a hand like that. I said, oh? He said, yes, there, Makiwara, boom, boom, boom. So I went there. He said, yeah, no, boom, 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 and keep going. I said, oh? So, wap, wap. Jesus, that hurts. Bam, bam, bam. And I had a big, but it's all water. And the next day I said, nice, nice. He said, yeah, but go again. I said, what? He said, you go again. So I thought, fuck it. And I said, knock. And all you hear is, and knock, knock, knock. 6 weeks later, I had knuckles, I hit the wall. And he said, good, good, good. So, from the second to third time, I was allowed to fight. And I fought with somebody who in the old days was third in the student championships karate. But don't forget, in those days, you were not allowed to hit. It was all, you know, in the air. So, I didn't know what to do, but I saw, always watch Kurosaki, because he was the big rough son of a bitch. And he always fought, not like this, he fought like this. And very fast with his feet. So, I went like this too. And this guy looked at me, and then I saw something funny in his eyes. He was afraid. So I, and he went like this. I gripped him and I made hanegoshi. Whoop, and he was hanging there. And Oyama looked up, whoop, stop. So I put the guy back. From that day on, they didn't want to really fight with me because they know if I have contact, I would throw him. And that's how it really started, all those things. It's ridiculous because you can find out easily that it is not possible even what they say. To start with, Oyama claimed, oh no, Oyama didn't claim, his students claimed, in these stupid books. The Japanese are crazy about those books. And all the lies and all the big stories they put in there. Not in real life. In this stupid. So. After Oyama died, one of his students put in the, one of those books, Oyama did 300 man kumite. And he fought for 3 days. Come on now. It's unbelievable. Several years ago, I hear championships in Paris, Kyokushin team championships. Then there is some Scots guy, he says, yes, and this is the Kyokushin guy, made famous by the famous Masoyama, who killed in his life 85 bulls. Now think about it. Until 1975, 76, when the last time I met him in 76, he has not killed any bulls because he hasn't fought any bulls. He has never even seen a bull. He fought in 1952, not a bull, an ox. But that's different. Then Oyama comes and he hits this poor ox. You see the picture? You see the eye of the ox? It's pure fear for what the fuck is going on. And then Kurosaki told me some years ago, and I have 3 witnesses there. Chris Dolman is 1 witness, and Maeda from Japan is a witness. Kurosaki went to Tateyama City to that ox with a hammer, and he hit the horn. So when Oyama came, boom, yeah, of course. It was loose already. And he never killed them. He never killed ox. They killed it in the abattoir, in the slaughterhouse. Why all those lies? So he asked Oyama, and he said, all monkey business, all public relations. So, okay. He said, we had to start Kyokushinkai, so we tried to make it famous like that. They say, oh, Oyama was always fighting in his dojo. I am the only one who was there 3.5 years. I have never even seen him 1 damn minute fighting with anybody. He was always doing the kihon, sit behind his desk, and Kurosaki was doing the same, footy here, and then the fighting. I have never seen him fighting. I'm sure he can fight, of course. And he did break techniques, he did that very well. But why all those stories? He would say, anybody who wants to do free fight can also do free fight in the Kyokushinkai. And I was supposed to be the teacher. I had to come to Japan every year at least twice for 6 weeks or 3 months. I would get an apartment there, I would travel first class, and I would get a percentage of the fights and things. So I would make a lot of money. So I said, well, if it is like that, it's okay. Well, you know what happened. Oyama got sick, and the 28th of April next year, instead of me going to Japan, Oyama died. Okay. And now they're almost sure that he was killed. He did not die of his sickness, because he was not that sick. He was killed by the Yakuza.